Okay, and we are live. The intro allows people to connect. I put a post up there for people to join and seem to have a reaction. So we'll, folks will be joining us. But welcome everybody to another episode of the TRoman Show with my esteemed co-host all the way from Las Vegas, which is in the news, T. Matthew Phillips. So thanks so much again for finding the time.
Hello. I know
you're busy. Yeah, yes. Everybody busy. Everybody's busy. So we have a couple topics to cover today. So no guest, but you know, if you have topics, if you have any ideas, please chime in. There was one topic that was suggested, which is maybe we'll dive into it quickly. But another unfortunate family court related shooting in actually in your hometown, right, Matthew? So that's something.
Yes, actually, you know. I had so many topics today I wanted to cover, but you're right. There was a shooting, and I guess you'd call it attorney on attorney crime, because I guess it was one attorney shot another attorney. So, but I don't know a lot about it. I don't know the people involved, but my understanding what happened was that the shooter is an attorney. And the shooter slash attorney is also a family court lawyer representing his client, who happens to be his son. So I thought that was kind of interesting. The shooter dad is representing his son in a family court proceeding. And so the shooter dad, mm-hmm. I'm sorry.
Well, no, and I go, and actually,
apparently,
one of the victims is also related to the shooter, right? According to the news, at least, you know, we don't have any firsthand information.
Yes. Mm-hmm.
Yes, sir.
Well,
go ahead.
Apparently the people that were shot was the son's ex-wife, because the shooter, remember, is an attorney representing his son against the ex-wife. So the shooter attorney shot the ex-wife of his son and also the ex-wife's attorney. You know, and the thing is, I'm thinking about this as I say it. I don't know whether the primary target was the other attorney or the mother, and I don't know if it really matters, I guess, but the whole thing is really tragic. But it's what's interesting to me about this, and this doesn't really surprise me that much when it happens, because you know, they treat people like animals, and the next thing you know, they start acting like animals and people wonder why, you know. But I think the main thing that was interesting about this case is that the child or children went to an aunt of the mother. And I'm thinking, why would that even happen? It seems to me like the living son, who is the parent of the children, that person should have, the father should have custody, not an aunt on the other side. And I'm still waiting to find out. I've tried to ask some people, but there's a lot of, I don't know if it's rumor or fact or fiction, but I'm trying to understand why it is that the children went to the aunt of the deceased mother, and why the children didn't go to the father, who's still living. Because the father didn't do anything. He didn't do any shooting. It was his dad that did the shooting, unless the family court is now operating under the supposition that the apple never falls very far from the tree. I mean, I just don't know. I haven't seen the rulings, and I'm hoping to see some of the orders in that case, and maybe we can do a show on that next time. So that's all I know.
Yeah, I just got the one of the outlets actually covering the story, you know, on the screen, just to make it somewhat more interesting to the viewers. But of course, you know, this whole thing, just on the level of the headlines, right, raises many important questions that all of us victims of the family court or facing the family court, the government machine, are grappling with, right? And that's of course emotions run high, and it has to be said explicitly that none of us here endorses any type of violence is not the solution, because we are in the middle of the worldwide Holocaust, and the government actually wants to incite violence. They provoke the population. That's at least my estimation and my assessment of what's going on everywhere. So it plays into their hands, right? So it's any tragedy like this will be used as a pretense to make harsher laws, you know, to remove fathers, it's mostly fathers, you know, but sometimes mothers further, And I actually posted on my Facebook a lot of news, actually a lot of articles coming out that females are not less capable of violence. They there are some characteristics to female violence, but similar, and actually more and more neutral research shows that men can be victims of female violence to the same extent as vice versa. So of course, violence is never the answer. It's not the answer. Our power is in there. Is, you know, I'm actually drawing from the wisdom of Jewish religion, and the power is in the mouth. The power is in the words. So we need to utilize the First Amendment in order to reform. I'm not sure reform is the right word. You cannot reform a concentration camp, but in order to address the issues that we are facing, right? But beyond that, you know, just what stands out to me is the fact that attorneys are involved, right? And if attorneys are not capable of resolving any issues through the court, right? What use is the court, right? The whole point in civilized society to creating courts was to prevent these types of situations, right? And apparently, the individuals involved did not feel that way. So according to the news, it was a prominent Las Vegas attorney in Las Vegas, actually in the news, Matthew. You know, the story of the guy who went horizontal, right? So I don't know if there's anything in the air, in the atmosphere there. I'm joking, but it's pretty astonishing that that's what's going on. So let's see, you know, people are joining us. Let's see if I have any comments here. Tara is saying she did not hear about that. So that's good. So we are actually acting in the news gathering capacity here. Derek is saying, hi, fellas. Hi, Derek. Very good. Oh, our prior guest is saying good evening. Hey, good evening to you too, Mr. Arnold. And I see your post. I think we all see your post. So thanks. Thanks for all your activism in this arena. Derek is saying entitlement and prejudice. Yep, we all know what's going on. So that's one topic, and we can always circle back. Now, there is another thing that I wanted to cover is actually updates from my federal case and an update on the attorney for the children in my case, Nicholas Morgolo. It's another public post, and I covered him before. So these are two topics that I had in mind, but If you had anything else that you want to put in the agenda of the hearing, counsel, just let me know.
Well, you know what I was thinking, actually, I was thinking about a quote. You just talked about the quote about violence, and you know this whole thing about violence, and you'd mentioned religious takes on violence and so forth. When I think about this idea of violence, of course, nobody supports it. But there's a quote by John Lennon, and I just found it here. I wanted to read it. It basically talks about when it comes down to violence. It says, then you are playing the system's game. The establishment will irritate you, pull your beard, flick your face to make you fight. Because once they've got you violent, then they know how to handle you. The only thing they don't know how to handle is nonviolence and humor. That's John Lennon, and I think that's so those are words of wisdom, I believe.
Excellent. Yeah, I respectfully concur. So Viridiana, thank you for joining. Thank you for all your activism, all your work, and all your sharing from all the way from Texas. Saying thank you for sharing the knowledge. I believe it's addressed to you primarily, my learned friend. And and Derek is saying that's actually a point to discuss, right? The courts, I believe, it was the intent to operate on delusions. Exposure to true information doesn't matter anymore. So it doesn't matter to the courts, but it does matter to the public. And that's what we are supposed to be doing, in my opinion. Because, again, you know, something that I emphasize in my public work is that I was born under a totalitarian regime. I was born in Soviet Russia. It was Soviet Union back then. It looked mighty and invincible. For 70 years, right? And then my family immigrated in the 1990 to Israel. But in 1991, after they held the usual military parade with planes and tanks and thousands of troops marching on the Red Square, it all crumbled actually in 3 days in August 1991. Why? How did that happen? It happened because the population overall was completely the right word? Satiated or saturated with the lies of the regime. So, and the key lie of the Soviet regime was exposed actually by legislators. There were a couple brave legislators who formed a group inside the Russian parliament, which was a mockery of legislature like everywhere else, I believe. And The Soviet government denied the existence of the Ribbentrop-Molotov Pact, in which actually Hitler and Stalin divided Europe between themselves. It was the agreement. So Molotov was the minister of foreign affairs for Russia, and Ribbentrop was for Nazi Germany, and they had an agreement which had a secret addendum in which they divided Poland into two. The Baltic countries went to Russia. The western part of Europe went to the Nazi Germany, and they denied. So the Soviet government denied the existence of the secret protocols for the duration of the existence of the Soviet Union. And eventually, the government was forced to admit. I actually put a link to a very interesting documentary about that. And that was the proverbial element, right, that broke the back of the camel. I don't remember the actual proverb, but it was the last drop, right, that actually uncovered the very foundational lie of the regime, that they always denied that they're better than Nazi Germany, the Bolsheviks are promoting freedom, whatever. And the population understood that they've been lied to for decades. Of course, it undermined any public trust. And when a coup d'etat, attempted coup d'etat happened, Gorbachev was locked in the Crimea, and a group of putsch, they called it putschists, the heads of all enforcement tentacles of the Soviet government came together, the head of the KGB, the head of the militia, they called the police there, the internal police. So it was a group of the most powerful individuals. And they actually, they ordered the troops to roll into Moscow, their famous pictures, right? When you see tanks on Red Square and soldiers with or in the vicinity of Red Square, soldiers with weapons who refused to shoot the population. So, from the government perspective, right, it was a colossal failure, because those who were supposed to enforce the might of the regime refused to do so, because they also understood that they're serving evil people. And the mighty Soviet Union, which just a couple months before demonstrated the military capabilities right to the whole world, crumbled in 3 days. The next leader of the Soviet Union, or the Russian Federation back then, Yeltsin, said to all the republics, you could take as much freedom as you want. I'm paraphrasing, but that's how ostensibly mighty powers can fold into their own footprint, right, in a couple of days, which I believe, you know, given the parallels that myself and so many people who grew up under Soviet regime see, that's where, unfortunately, America and the Western world are going. So we are moving backward. So the country is becoming more and more totalitarian, right? And you see the lies, mm-hmm. and on a much more massive scale, because it's worldwide scale. But once the population is saturated with the lies, they cannot, normal people are normal. They cannot stand when they're being lied to, right, for a long time, basically on everything. And at some point, people start despising the government official, the whole regime that subjects them to this very, very smart, very intricate system of slavery. And coming full circle, Derek, you know, to the comment that I have on the screen, at least my opinion and my experience as somebody whose family was liberated, essentially, by the same freedom direction of movement, right, is that we need to continue talking, we need to continue educating other people, and that's I believe God put us all in these places, right? We're scattered across America, across the world, in different countries, different states, but we come together thanks to this new technology, and that's how we can exchange our experiences and insights, right? So talking to the court, I agree, is mostly useless. It is useful in that sense that we show other people who still believe, they harbor the naive perception that courts are just, the courts are just another tentacle of the government. Or if you go to the press, it will help. No, we are the press now. If you go to the press, they're just a propaganda arm. So that's mm-hmm. that's why talking and exposing and making shows, and everybody should make shows and come and interview each other, expose, be public, not be afraid. That's how the slavery will end. And it is connected. It's proportional to the number of people who speak up, the speed with which the slavery we are under will crumble. So the more people speak out, the quicker we and our children will be liberated. So that's my rant. Matthew, your turn.
No, I couldn't. I can't follow up on that one. It's the same thing as slavery. I'm sure there was a time where slavery in America was so embedded in the culture that nobody could imagine a system without it. And the economies would completely collapse if you got rid of all this property, the value, everybody would be, you know, but they got rid of the system. And so I'm optimistic that the current Holocaust that we now face, that it will end one day. We shall overcome. And I'm confident. It's just a question, like you said, of time. And I think that time scale will come quicker the more people that get on the bandwagon and start exposing this and speaking truth to power. I think that's the main reason to be bringing lawsuits, is to speak truth to power. And eventually, one day soon, hopefully they'll listen. So,
yeah, again, you know, I don't have, at least, you know, I don't have a lot of hope that they will listen. And I'm not sure they need to listen, you know, or we need to try to make them listen. You know, other people need to listen. Ourselves, right? Ultimately, the power comes from the people. It's a pyramid with a very, very tight, you know, layer of actual rulers at the top. We probably don't know who they are, most likely. And it's all a show for us. It's all just a show for the masses. It's very, very clear to those who have their eyes open. You know, with the people, once we, it's all in the Bible. it was all predicted. You know, we the people understand where we live. We understand we are complete slavery. That's going to be the solution, and it's up to us actually to spread the knowledge. So I want to acknowledge it's very enlightening, actually, lovely to see that people are interacting in the comments. Jacob is saying hello. Jacob, of course, was on the show. Jacob, thank you for sharing your story. Jacob had his sentence in hearing those. Just go on his page, and I posted it. So for texting his ex, he was put on 2-year probation. Thank God, not in jail, not incarcerated, but of course, it's on the face of it, prima facie, it looks like a fascist outcome. So, any details? And Jacob, if you want, you know, we can make another recap. Marcus, thanks for joining, Mark, all the way from California. Jacob is in Colorado. Mark is saying sunshine is the best disinfectant. Yes, you know, they that's a yes. Famous line, right? By who was that Supreme Court judge, right? Before. Yeah, before he became he used it all the time, but they ignore it. I use it myself. So very good. So I think we can move to the second topic that I had in mind, which is an update on my federal case. Now I let me just try to present it as well. So I'll share the screen with the response that I got. Let me know if it's. If it's visible, should be visible now. So I'll just scroll to it. I posted it on Fire, Jeanette McFarland page, group that I manage. It's and other victims of Jeanette McFarland, Richmond County, Reichman County Family Court are involved. But what I got is that, just to quickly recap, I filed a federal lawsuit against Jeanette McFarland and her court guard, Lavanko, who physically assaulted me and prevented me from being present in the next party hearing de facto taking place in my case. And another hearing, which I tried to attend with another court watcher, as we are allowed without any reservations or exemptions under Section 4 of New York State judiciary law. All court proceedings are public in family court. There are some other exceptions, but they do not apply to family court. I was physically blocked by him. He shouted at me. And what's interesting is that, I'm just jumping forward a little bit, that he's not denying, at least for the purpose of the motions that were submitted right now, motion to dismiss, he, through his attorney provided by the state, it's a separate topic, he's not denying my allegations. So I'm just scrolling to that, but anyone can see. And all the documents are public on PACER. PACER is the system, the document management system, used by the federal courts. What is infuriating to some extent, or some may say that we don't pay enough in taxes, so we need to pay for the use of the PACER. The good thing is that if you downloading of each page is 10 cents, which quickly adds up if you have multi-page documents, obviously, and if you have multiple cases, you know, look up other cases. But as long as your use does not exceed $30 in a quarter, they don't charge you. So You need to be judicious in what you download, what you look at. But basically, it is free up to a certain threshold. Anyway, it is public. All documents are public. This is one of the only avenues we have to expose what's really going on in these courts. So federal cases can be very, very useful. And at least you get these nomenclatura players in the state judiciary and the judicial system to reply if you are able to overcome sua sponte dismissal. So back to my case, I sued McFarland, the judge in my case, who violated my rights left and right. Just unbelievable, all described there. The case got routed to Judge Ann Donnelly, who is a former state judge. And she dismissed, actually I filed twice, she dismissed both cases sua sponte without even requesting a reply. I covered that. That's my opinion, and I'm utilizing my First Amendment as always to describe that. But she twisted my argument in order to show as if I sued for money. I didn't sue for money. I sued for injunctive and declaratory relief because I was aware that if you sue for money, that's actually a developed sub-doctrine of judicial immunity that allows to dismiss a case. So my words were twisted, unfortunately, to present as if I did it, even though I explicitly said it's not. The case was dismissed. I appealed. I filed another case, and this time I with new violations, of course, because violations happened throughout all the case, the whole case. And this time I included McFarland's guard, Lavanko. Judge Donnelly, the federal judge, former state judge, who is, by the way, still receiving state money, I asked for her recusal, disqualification. It didn't help, so she remained on the case. I appealed the decision. That appeal got denied. I'm now in the period where I need to decide where to file a request, essentially leave, right, certiorari to the Supreme Court of the United States. I'm still within the time period and within my rights to do that. But anyway, long story short, the branch of my case against Lavanko, the court guard, survived, which potentially means that my case is moving toward the jury trial as a pro se litigant. And at least what I got so far is finally I got the state to respond. So that's their response. As expected, by the way, it took the U.S. Marshal Service more than a month to serve him, even though he's a court guard. He's a court guard. You just go to the court and you serve him the paper. So it didn't help. One tip that I will share with the audience is that I actually called the Eastern District New York in New York of New York Federal Court has a pro se department. So I spoke to somebody who answers the phones there. I said, what's going on? The judge said that Lavanko needs to be served, and he wasn't. So apparently it did work behind the scenes somehow. They probably most likely talked to each other. So after more than a month, he was served, and he was required to submit a response. So unsurprisingly, the attorney general for the New York State, Letitia James, stepped into the arena, and through another attorney, that's the way it works. Her name is Melissa Yisagire. I hope I'm not botching her name. Assistant Attorney General is now representing Mr. Lavanko, the court guard. Now, that's a separate topic, Matthew, and I'd be curious to hear your thoughts, is that why state officials immediately get public attorney? Is it, listen, you know, like if another person, if somebody else, a normal person, not belonging to the government nomenclatura, is accused of something, right? We don't get any help automatically, right? We need to jump through hoops. But these people, and prima facie, you know, my case is raising serious questions of his behavior, right? He's still not paying out of his pocket. He gets the representation probably, you know, I would assume the best lawyers in New York, right? Those who work for attorney general, even though it's debatable. But why is this automatic assignment of state money that I'm still paying for? What are your thoughts?
You know, it's a great question, and I wonder myself all the time, because it does seem awfully unfair that they should get free attorneys. It really does, because then there's, again, almost no disincentive for them to not do things in the first place. They figure, well, go ahead and sue me. It's not like I have to pay for a lawyer. I think that they should have to do at a minimum some kind of copay. But I also think that there's a conflict of interest this is a great question, and we've never talked about this one, but I think it's a conflict of interest to have the executive branch, because the state's attorney general is part of the executive branch. And I wonder, is this court guard part of the judicial branch or the law enforcement branch, because I think there should not be that hybridization is not the right word. But the point is, if they did get a lawyer, it should be somebody in the judicial sphere and not in the, you know, attorney general's office. Maybe a more fair way to do it would be to have the state subsidize the purchase of a private attorney and then have the defendant pay partially for the attorney. I don't know if that's a workable solution, but I just think it's a conflict of interest. I don't know how to get around it, but the thing that you always see is the attorney general rushing to represent these people. Except for, I got to say, what's so curious now that I'm saying all this, in our class action lawsuit in Los Angeles, we're suing the judicial council and also the Supreme Court of California, the Chief Justice. And they didn't get the Attorney General. They got a private law firm. And again, that begs another question. Who's paying for it? Are the taxpayers paying for it? Is there any kind of oversight knowing that it's a private law firm that's being hired? I mean, there's so many issues here, but the bottom line is I don't think they should get a totally free lawyer. I mean, personally, I'd be willing to say that the state should maybe subsidize some of the cost, and I think it should be a lawyer not connected to the state. That's my feeling. What do you think?
Yeah, no, I agree. It's actually, you're highlighting another interesting point, because it seems that every state, or maybe every judge, right? Every judge or every state actor is free to do whatever they want. So I think you're highlighting very interesting two questions, right? So first of all, why court guards actually are part of the court system, right? And the second question, you know, why are they automatically represented by the executive branch, right? So the whole system, if you go back to the roots, right, and the idea was to make America the freest country on earth, right, and people died for this notion, right, we need to constantly hold back to the moral principles and the constitutional principles of the country, even if the judges don't do that, right, or other actors in the government. But one of the key ideas was checks and balances, right, and that's why, you know, that's why Americans fought for the idea that the monarchs will not rule this land, right? What is a monarch? Monarch is a person who actually combines all branches of power, right? The judicial, the executive, and the legislative power. So, and why? Because too much power concentrated in one, we're saying the basics, right? But apparently, you know, in our time, as to paraphrase Orwell, you know, those who are saying the basics, you know, repeating the basics or saying the truth, right, are considered brave. So the basics is if the king concentrates all the power, you know, that's absolutism, right? They can do whatever they want. And the idea was to separate it in order for them, you know, to control each other or to balance each other. So in potentially enforcement, right, and nobody disputes that people can behave in an unlawful manner even inside the courts, right, even though, you know, you and I and people with whom we interact are completely peaceful. Again, you know, we're just utilizing our First Amendment as is our full right. That's the only country in which it's actually on the paper, right? But So people violate the law all the time in the courts, outside the courts, right, in police precincts, who knows, you know, but let the usual police force handle it. Why there should be a dedicated armed force in the courts? That's a question. That's a philosophical slash political question, right? But that's not something that is given as granted. And just theoretically, let's say, you know, regular NYPD officers would be tasked also with providing security in the courts, right? They might be less prone to the corruption, or if they maybe if they saw you know, I don't know, bribes being exchanged, right, in judges' chambers, right, they might be more likely to report on that. That might be another check against corruption in the court system. But of course, they are part of the court system. Actually, in New York, I believe the court guards are the third largest weaponized force in the state. That's a big thing, right? So and we are paying for it. By the way, the rules by which they operate are not transparent. My friend, our friend here on the show, Jim Kelly, James Kelly, actually requested that. I filed a full request. I didn't get too far. He got slightly farther than me, and he got a couple chapters. But by and large, the rules by which the court guards operate are not exposed to the public, unlike the patrol guide, for example, for NYPD. So it's some sort of obscured, very dangerous, you know, very violent, as my case shows, force, potentially violent, and actually practically violent, because I was attacked, assaulted by Lovanko, as he is not denying for the purpose of the paper that I'm presenting around, right? So we don't know under what rules they actually operate. So that's not normal. That's one thing. Another thing is why suddenly the executive branch, and that's the point that you are highlighting, Matthew, right? Is why the executive branch is rushing to represent him? Why it's now Brick versus Lovanko, right? At least you know, in America we still preserve that notion that you are suing a government official in the personal capacity, right? Which, if he violated the law, that was his personal choice. He wasn't the guy that to attack me, mm-hmm. or to block the entrance of court observers, right? So, yeah. But so the paper, right? If anybody Googles Brick versus Lovanko, they will find it. But why, if I'm suing him personally, Mr. Lovanko, right? He's the defendant. He's the respondent. Why he is entitled to get the executive branch to represent him, right? That's another mixture, right? Exactly as you are saying. So they rush to, if let's say it was a private attorney, right, representing him, which in my opinion should be the norm, right? Maybe the private attorney would say, Mr. Lovanko, you know what Mr. Brick here alleges is actually egregious. You should actually admit to your fault, right? Instead, you have the infinite state budget to fight it, to file motions, to engage in this war of attrition. So that's just one aspect. But again, you know, that's my job. I know that I'm a David against Goliath, like all of us are here. But at least, you know, I am exposing, these documents are public. His name is preserved to posterity. What these people did to me and my children throughout the years that I've been fighting for a simple thing to be a father. It's all preserved. And again, when people speak out, right, these are not just vague allegations. You see, I wrote this thing. It's out there. It has my signature. I know. I stand behind my words. It's all truth. Okay? It's part of the public record now. So let's see how that develops. Let me just go through the comments here. So Jacob is saying, and that's the comment that I had up there, that they did the same thing in his federal cases, because the AG, of course, in Colorado, representing the state, and they include private party defendants. Okay, there's case law that says that if a private party actually acts as part of the government gang, right, they can be sued as part of the government under the 1983 mm-hmm. lawsuits, violations under the color of law. So they all moved joint motions, filed joint motions to stay. Now, Nancy, in another state, is saying that the attorney general is representing CPS in the case with my granddaughter. Attorney general is an elected position by the people, yet the attorney general represents the state. Yeah, how is this right? Absolutely. So that's excellent discussion here in the comments, but people are supporting what you're saying. And that's great. Catherine is joining from California, right? Saying hi, all. Dave is joining. Dave Murray from New Jersey. Excellent. We have a great representation here. So that's how we find each other on the network and on the internet. That's how it's supposed to develop and grow. So let's see. Just one interesting comment from Nancy. Nancy is a great fighter from North Carolina, if I'm not mistaken, or I'm always confused. North Carolina and West Virginia are the also atrocious states in terms of parental rights and grandmother in this case rights. I don't get the free attorney was referred to legal aid. Legal aid denied representing a third party in the CPS case. Senator Joe Manchin told me to call West Virginia. Sorry for that. To try to get help.
I found it. You know, can I,
Go ahead. Sorry.
I didn't mean to interrupt you. I just, as I'm reading this legal aid thing, it's kind of triggering like a personal thing in my case. I don't know if I've mentioned this before, but my ex gets the free government lawyer, you know what I mean? And I can understand some occasions where maybe there's a guy who's got all the money and freezes out the mother and she's destitute and needs a free lawyer to get going or something. But in my case, my ex has gotten a free lawyer for going on 6 years now in family court actions, in related actions, in appellate action, she's gotten a free attorney. And basically in every litigation where I've opposed her, and I've opposed her in several, different fora, even in the United States Supreme Court, my ex got a free lawyer to practice law in the United States Supreme Court. And that's not by any means an inexpensive thing. And it's really just amazing to me the amount of money that these other people are spending on my ex-wife. And it always makes me wonder, are they spending it to benefit her or are they spending it to detriment me? Because I feel like I'm the, you know, the targeted person here is targeted by the system. But I'll tell you another one too about these employees. I'm curious, is Lovanco considered a county employee or a state employee? And the reason I say this is, you know, the court system seems to operate on a county-wide basis. And yet, even the people who run for judge, they run in a county election. But despite that fact, once they become a judge, now they're a state employee. And that is true in New York, in Nevada, rather, and in California. And so what happens, the difference is, as a state employee, now they get 11th Amendment immunity, or ostensibly anyway. But if they're a county employee, there wouldn't be the same kind of immunity, because we know that counties are considered persons for purposes of a 42 USC 1983 action. So that's another conundrum too. And you can see why all of a sudden, all of these county employees would suddenly want to call themselves state employees, because now the 11th Amendment will shield them from a lawsuit in federal court. It won't necessarily, you know, give them immunity from liability generally, but just in federal court. But then of course, your only alternative is to go to state court, and that just doesn't seem like an option, which to me is one of the saddest commentaries on our legal system today. And I talk to people all the time who want to bring in action, they want to sue a judge, they want to sue opposing counsel, and the idea of doing it in state court seems impossible, because the state courts have really shown that they're not going to enforce the Constitution, that they're not going to stand up for individual liberties, and our only hope is to go to the federal court. And I don't know, I wonder, maybe the federal courts are getting sick of plaintiffs such as we, who are knocking on the door saying, federal government, can you help us? The state courts have fallen below the minimum constitutional guarantee. We want our constitutional rights. And maybe we got to keep knocking louder. I don't know. At some point, I don't know.
No, I agree with you completely, respectfully. Yes, we need to keep knocking louder, you know, through the courts, through the federal system. Again, you know, I always try to look at the big picture, and the question that we are facing, the problem and the tyranny we are facing, it's not a judicial problem. It's not a jurisprudential problem. It's not a legal problem. It's a societal problem. We are in the middle of, it's a communist problem, right? We're in the middle of the worldwide takeover. And we have guests here from Canada. We have a guest from Europe. I need to reconnect with a father from New Zealand. You know, those who follow my page, and again, I'm very grateful for each and everyone. But we see people from all over the developed world, so-called, right? We see how developed it is now. It's a worldwide problem of governmental takeover. We are under tyranny. It's slithering, and there at this stage, in my opinion, at least the way I see it, and I think millions now are seeing that, they dropped all pretenses. They just—it's a mad rush toward the final goal. It's the death march, right? That the Nazis did at the end of the Second World War. They know they're exposed. They don't care because at this stage they consolidate basically all the power. But again, you know, we need to turn over their heads of the government and newspapers and all the subverted institutions that we have to other people, because they can only operate if other people don't understand or are afraid. And there's nothing to be afraid of, because God is in control. It's important to remember. So, I think in New York, because New York is at the forefront of this Bolshevik push, right? Just trying to shove it down the throats. New York, California, we see that. So they are state employees. That's why the Lovanco is part of the New York court system. They have their own affiliated with the state apparatus. And I agree with you now that we are talking about that, right? That was done most certainly in order to shield them, right? To shield them from all responsibility. So the slight glimmer of hope is that because he is a court guard and not a judge, he does not enjoy absolute immunity. He has qualified immunity, right? So there's some slight chance that he will be held responsible eventually. But of course, they will not let it back to the county level. You mentioned that suing the state in the state court. It's ridiculous. It's preposterous, right? So you're trying to hold agents of the same system in the same system. Like it's ridiculous, right? It's going to one tentacle of the mafia, you know, like and complain to the bosses about the underbosses, right? It's we know it's laughable.
Yeah.
Moreover, what's interesting is that in New York, there's a law that bypasses essentially the statute of limitations or negates it. So if you do not submit a notice of claim, I believe it's 90 days or 120 days. I think it's 90 days to the state comptroller, right? You lose your right to sue them in state court. It's just unbelievable. But and many plaintiffs who are not aware of that, right? People who are not lawyers or they run out of money to hire lawyers. They're not aware of that, and that's it. Like how can it be? If you sue the state, right? It's not a normal term. And people lose. People, they reject your claim just based on the, superficial technical grounds. And that's it, right? So in that sense, federal court is also, more amenable to listening to you. But I don't have any hope. So the key goal is again, to expose it all, right? To preserve the record so they cannot deny that Lavanko did that to me and McFarland did that to me to my children. So regardless of what they're doing now, because they're all powerful, right? The public is waking up. And I think everybody can see that the public is waking up. And we see more and more people active in Texas, on your side of the country, right? And that's why, we try to lead by example. Again, not doing anything illegal, just exposing it through the First Amendment. But that's how we take over and rein in this monster. I wanna just quickly cover another aspect in what I have on the screen, if you allow, Matthew, because that's what I had on my agenda.
Yes.
Let me just try to scroll. So, what is interesting? I'm curious again to hear your thoughts. So, what was submitted actually is notice of motion to partially dismiss the amendment complaint. Right. So, I knew that that's a standard modus operandi by the government agents. They will try to to dismiss my motion, but the motion was submitted was a motion to dismiss it partially. So, and just to highlight what I mean here is that I raised multiple allegations against Mr. Lavanko here, right, which are listed here. So violation of First Amendment right to freedom of speech, freedom of press. I'm a card holding bearing member of New York City Press Corps, excessive force, false arrest, conspiracy to violate my First Amendment rights, battery, assault, and intentional infliction of emotional distress. Now, so I listed here 7 paragraphs, essentially, in my complaint, right? They're listed here, for which I want to hold Mr. Lavanko accountable. Now, the motion is essentially asking the court to dismiss, without the jury trial, everything but the first paragraph or the first allegation, which are facts. That's a violation of my First Amendment right to freedom of speech. So that's an interesting thing. I think that I don't know how often you saw in your practice being done, but the partial dismissal actually might indicate that at least even if Judge Donnelly, who again is just a part of the same system, even though she allowed the case to proceed, for which I'm grateful. Even if she accepts the motion to dismiss, at least one key item will survive, which will allow me to proceed to the jury trial. What are your thoughts?
Mm-hmm. You know, if you get to the jury trial, it's always a home run because you want to get in front of a jury, you want to do that trial, and you want to hit the home run. And, you know, so I think that's terrific news. I think it's fantastic. And I would love to do a jury trial against in a situation like this, you know. But and I also think that if it actually comes down to doing a trial, I think some of these attorneys would never be able to actually pull it off. You know, they're just sitting behind the desk and just typing up these motions. Rooker Feldman, you know, Younger abstention doctrine, domestic proceeding exception, Rooker Feldman, on and on and on. And but if it actually got to trial, I think it'd be fantastic. And I think it's a huge victory. And I just think it's absolutely terrific. So,
No, thank you. Thank you. No, actually, thank God that that's proceeding this way. Again, you know, doesn't mean that they cannot pull other, you know, rabbits, right, out of the head. But but at least, you know, at this stage, it seems that they're not contesting. Now, I wonder if the fact that they're not contesting, that they're just saying for the purpose of the motion to dismiss, they accept my allegations as facts. So why does Lavanka continue actually serving the system? I don't know if he does. I need to double check. But if they admit that he did that, he pushed me, he blocked my entrance to the courtroom, why is he not suspended at least, right? These are all good questions. But anyway, one other aspect that I want to highlight. So the Judge Donnelly, that's procedural question that I need to figure out. Again, I'm representing myself pro se, and it's impossible. You need to learn family law, constitutional law, federal procedure, appellate procedure. It's just unbelievable what you need to do, because attorneys would not do that, right? I don't know anybody like you in New York, right? So, and I went through multiple attorneys. But anyway, you know, I'm doing what I can. And the case, after it was allowed to proceed, was referred to a magistrate judge. And then suddenly I'm getting a scheduling order from Ann Donnelly, again, not from the magistrate judge. So I wonder what it means, right? So probably the case is under her very, very close supervision. Now, she set a scheduling order because she suspended, based on the motion, she suspended the schedule for discovery. And she didn't ask me what I think about that, about the immediate suspension. But she did ask me to provide a reply to the motion to dismiss. And before that, to the intermediary request to suspend discovery. So the scheduling order itself was issued without asking me for the dates, even though she was amenable when I asked for an adjournment or continuance in the date. So anyway, that's an interesting thing that I wanted to cover. Any other last comments? And we'll probably go back to this federal lawsuit again. I published it.
You know what I was going to say is the court is always going to presume the truth of the allegations at the pleading stage, and the defendant may be going along with it, just because they really can't, you know, change the facts or plead otherwise or plead ignorance, you know. But maybe the strategy is to have a trial. Maybe that's what they want, but they're going to try to argue the good faith card that, yes, the guy did this, and yes, he did engage in the alleged acts. However, in his defense, he did it in good faith, and he did it reasonably. I mean, they may try to do something like that, but then again, you leave it to a jury, and I think that's a different kettle of fish you put it in front of a jury. So,
I think fundamentally what the government is doing everywhere, and on the state level and the federal level, they are blocking our access to juries. That's what they do, because jury, and that's a fundamental thing that Americans fought for, right? A jury is a key tenet of the constitutional foundation that we have in this country, right? That's very, very important. Again, I was educated in the Israeli legal profession, legal background, right, legal foundation, and there are no juries anywhere. So it's all so-called professional judges, which the government completely controls. They're part of the government. So jury, that's a right for which people fought and died, right, introduces a level of uncertainty for the government, uncertainty of result, and they want certainty of results, right? And that's why we're seeing juries being blocked in every court, of course, in family courts, even in civil courts in the state, because this motion to dismiss, it's a standard operating procedure, SOP for all of them, right? And even in federal court, it's just very, very hard to get to a jury trial. So another guest that we had on the show, Mark Fishman, he was able to proceed to a jury trial in his case, but it took years, right? So hopefully this case is moving, my case is moving faster. Hopefully I will get a jury trial, and I'm happy to present my case. I know that I'm right. I know that my right as a member of the public to be present and to oversee the judges that are paid by taxpayers' money was violated by Lavanka. He attacked me for no reason. He pushed me. He blocked another court watcher. All these are facts. I'm happy to present them, and I think the government cannot be certain in the result. If I do get to present my case to a jury. So I expect all kind of games by all parties involved to block my access to the jury, but maybe not. Maybe I'll be able to set a precedent. It's very sad that the only thing, the only semblance of responsibility that I'm able, out of thousands, literally thousands of due process violations, is the fact that now at least this case is proceeding against the court guard. But the judge, with whom he is clearly very tightly coordinated, was at least for now left out of the case. So we'll see how that goes. One other topic that I wanted to cover, and we are coming up on our self-imposed deadline, is is, and you tell me as an attorney, is the behavior of an attorney who was forced on me by the court, and his name is Nicholas Mourgolos. Let me pull his Twitter account here. And again, he referred to the First Amendment when I mentioned the same facts in court. So he should be he should have no problem with me presenting it. So let me share the screen with his Twitter. Okay, so hopefully you see that, right? This is a public account of Nicholas Mourgolos. And he proudly, I'll just emphasize the go. And thank you, everybody. I see that a lot of people are actually watching. That's amazing. I am grateful. I know that TMP is grateful. So Nicholas Mourgolos, he's a family law attorney, right? So he's proudly presenting that. He's also a Scotch enthusiast, right? And if you can see, he has an open alcohol container here and a child. I believe he is childless. He doesn't have children of his own. He lives in his mother's house in New Jersey, even though he gets cases in New York. So he's effectively, for all intents and purposes, he's an employee once removed of the court system, right? But he presents an open alcohol container of hard alcohol, Scotch enthusiast, right? Close to a minor child, clearly. I don't know if he's nephew or something like that. It's, again, it's a public profile. But what's more interesting is for example, that's a very recent tweet that he had, right? So I will not quote it, but everybody can read, right? So you see the F bombs that he's throwing? Like F Joe, right? F disgrace, the a-hole, right? And F this guy. And this guy, again, this person is an attorney in New York. Not only he is an attorney, he's also allowed to represent small children. And this is his public behavior. Is this normal? I'm asking the audience, I'm asking you. You're an attorney. Like, I haven't seen or haven't heard you cursing, using expletives, let alone, you know, on his public Twitter. So I exposed that, right? And he made his Twitter private. But then, you know, I just double-checked it recently because I had to file another paper in my court file, right? And lo and behold, it's back public again. What is this thing? Tell me, is this normal behavior?
Well, I'm curious, who is he cursing about? Is he cursing, like, to be funny or cursing for name-calling or... You know why? I guess the reason is why is he doing it? You know.
Yeah, but he's apparently a baseball fan. I'm not into sports. Mm-hmm. I love basketball, not this type, at least of sports. So he's cursing at the umpire. I don't know, but that's a public behavior by an attorney, right? So let's say you encountered an attorney in the supermarket, right? If they live in the vicinity, right? And they start cursing at the person, you know, in the supermarket. Using expletives, F you and F that and F that and AL, you know, is it the normal behavior? Wouldn't you expect the attorney to be reprimanded for that? Is it what the public expects from people? Now, that's even more egregious because it's a public Twitter account, right? Potentially thousands are. He doesn't have a lot of followers, which is a good thing, right? He has what 48. You know, I again not to brag, but I see numbers of 70,000, you know, in a short time period, you know, on my Facebook. Thanks everybody, probably including him. But that's like shouting in the public square. Is it something that you know you as an attorney licensed in another state, you expect your colleagues to behave that way?
The thing is, I think we're supposed to have rules of civility and rules of decorum in talking with other attorneys. You know, I think if it's on the general public, they could probably say whatever they want. But I think you do make a good point. I have to say, if he's representing children and children are looking up to him and say they're teenagers and they can, you know, see him, that might be a little bit different just because of the nature of the work he does. And so you may have a point there if he works with children and the children are supposed to I guess, esteem him in some fashion because he's their attorney. But it seems like that would be an issue because of the children, so.
I do think that there are two aspects there, right? So first of all, you know, he is an attorney. He's a licensed attorney in New York, and I believe in New Jersey as well. That's one thing, right? So he's admitted to represent people. Now, beyond that, he's also qualified by what is called an AFC panel. The AFC is attorney for the children. That's the four is debatable there, which is separate qualification, right? So there's essentially two barriers that he had to pass in order to be allowed to represent small children in family court. Now, again, you know, from my experience in Israel, the bar of behavior is higher for attorneys and judges, right? Or like it is, you know, for doctors or other members whose function in society depends on public trust. That bar of behavior is higher, and that's why you have rules of ethics, right? So I'm not contesting his First Amendment right to say what he wants. He can say what he wants, right? I'm not trying to undermine his ability to curse or to use expletives in his speech, right? What I'm saying, it puts into a very questionable light his ability to be a lawyer, let alone a lawyer representing the children, right? So as a human being, as a citizen of the United States, he's entitled to say what he wants, right? And nobody's blocking him from saying that. The question is, if a person who behaves that way in publicly on a public platform is somebody that the public wants to see as an attorney. My answer is resoundingly no. I don't think that's an acceptable behavior for an attorney. Mark, I suppose, yeah.
No,
Go ahead.
I mean, I kind of agree and a little bit disagree. I think sometimes, you know, because I can be, I think I can be very aggressive sometimes, and some people mistake, you know, the attorney type aggression. But, you know, you hear people on one side talk about we need more civility and attorneys need to be more respectful and polite. But then again, I get calls all the time from people who are just hopping mad and they're cursing, and, you know, they want a lawyer who's going to be aggressive and over the top and that kind of thing. And people want that. And so maybe if they see an attorney who's outspoken and maybe more rough around the edges, that may be attractive to some clients, you know. But it's a fascinating topic. I just think my problem with this particular fella is that he probably shouldn't be representing children and also hold himself out, you know, saying some of the things he does. Because, you know, the children may look up to him and get a kind of a misimpression. So, because they would, if he's their lawyer, he's supposed to be like the knight in shining armor. And there shouldn't be an instance where they see him kind of, you know, being less than that. But if he were just a regular civil litigator, you know, maybe it might be more appropriate, you know. So, I don't know, but it's a very interesting question because I get complaints like that. I know people have told me that they've complained to the state bar about me. I haven't seen the complaints and they never materialize into anything. But other people have told me that they've complained about me because they thought my behavior was too over the top or too unprofessional or, you know. But again, those things never materialized. They never, complaints never became anything. But, it's a fascinating topic, though.
Yeah, it's a good discussion, you know, at least between us, right? We can have the First Amendment, you know, rights, right? So it's the divergence of opinion is welcome. I in nothing that you said, Matthew, you mentioned, and I never heard you, from knowing you for quite some time now, that you use the F word, you know, extensively, let alone, you know, four times, using four expletives in the course of one tweet. Yes, you know, you can, and sometimes, you know, especially attorneys, right? I would agree, you need to use in the course of their work, you know, again, maybe somewhat more colorful language, but I don't think using the F, you know, which is just filthy language. It shows, in my opinion, and my personal opinion experience, again, you know, I'm going back to the religious side of it, right? But the people who curse, you know, you're not supposed to curse, right? It's unethical for a regular person, let alone an attorney, right? And to say something like that, it just means it's primitive, in my opinion. It's primitive, it's filthy. That's not a normal behavior for any educated person, not an educated professional. And And if he doesn't care what people think about the attorneys, right, then maybe other attorneys need to care, right? That's the image that that the person like that projects, right? That, you know, and again, you know, I think it's important, again, to mention that he already made his Twitter private, and now he made it public, and he continues. So it's almost impulsive, uncontrollable behavior. He needs to curse on his Twitter. Why? He cannot communicate normally. I believe it's egregious, yeah. You know. But more beyond all that, so, you know, there's also an aspect of admitting to loving hard alcohol, you know, scotch, and making, being proud of that. Like, what is to be so proud of, you know? That's, people used in prior times, people used that to be proud about books they read, you know, education they received, right? You know, concepts that they developed, you know, causes they promote. This guy is talking about sports, drinks, and F-bombing, you know, somebody he doesn't like. That's an attorney. That's a person who says, I think it's despicable. You know, that's at least my opinion. Well, not only that, that's still lower. And again, he likes the First Amendment. I like the First Amendment. So, what? Go ahead. Sorry. Yeah.
Well, I was going to say, I think it may be kind of a low class thing too. You know, but I think it also may depend on, you know, is he cursing because there's a specific thing? And he's mad about that specific thing, and he's using the cursing as an adjective to emphasize that thing. You know, that may be different than gratuitous cursing just for the sake of cursing. That's kind of more, I don't know, low class, and, you know, you don't really need to do it at some point, you know.
Oh, he curses all the time. That's just one tweet that's very recent. That's why I highlighted it. But, you know, I can scroll down. I actually have the post. You know, I documented it all. It's a public tweet, but. He uses the F, you know, all the time. Just if you scroll down, you'd see it's one of his favorite words, you know. So, yeah, look at this, but just cursor. You see June 25, 2023, F joke, you know. So he's what the F he's doing, you know. Just, you see, it's suck, you know. That's the language.
It's
huh? That's the language. I don't know. In my opinion, it's. It's egregious. That's not the type of attorneys that I think New York State deserves, and certainly not an attorney that New York State taxpayers should fund. His lifestyle, by the way, in New Jersey, right, with taxpayer money, and let alone having access to the children. So let's see. Let's just go quickly to the comments. Mark is saying Kasanov. Yeah, that's a famous case of. Attorney Kasanov, and then the mother who unfortunately essentially committed assisted suicide. He was disbarred in New York for his videos. Mark is also adding he needs a mental diversion to keep his license, like that of Carlos Martinez. Okay, so you know, just to finish the point, because, you know, obviously I'm related to the case, and it's just unbelievable. This person is forced on me, literally forced. To represent my children. Why estate? I offered, by the way, to have a private attorney potentially. McFarlane never even provided any reasons. Why both children are viewed as one lump child and I'm represented by this F cursing individual, I also don't know. So I'm obviously just, it's very clear to all of us, I made multiple videos on that AFC is essentially just another attorney provided to the alienator by the state. So they have one provided by the government, like in your case, whether it's through the government or through grants, you know, private firm. And then they have another one who is ostensibly, you know, representing the children, but de facto represents the other party, also paid for by the state. You have no say. They belong to a very tight clique of people that are favorites of the judges. In his case, in the case of Morgolo, that's not the only thing. That's just a very open, very public thing. But, for example, he never met with me. He never asked for my opinion. How can he continue being considered a professional attorney when he doesn't even meet or speak about the issues faced by the children with the father of the children? In my opinion, it's mind-boggling.
But, you know, I'm going to say it only has to appear semi-plausible to those not caught in the jaws of the system. And so he doesn't care about actually helping families, apparently. All he's caring about is creating a record and pushing paper and making it look legit to people on the outside. And, you know, it's funny you say he's a government paid attorney. Sometimes you'll see a person like myself who, if you work for yourself, you may be more have, looser lips, so to speak, when you're in social media. But if somebody's getting paid from the government or they're a government attorney, they're generally more, not conservative, but traditional. And so that's kind of interesting if he's on the government payroll and still kind of acting like that. So
So that's an interesting point,
that's
because
interesting.
he's not employed directly by the court system. But by the way, in New York, you can see the schedule. Maybe next time I'll just show it on the you can check the schedule of attorneys in the on the website of the New York court system. And majority of his cases are assigned by the court, by the same judges. So de facto, that's my argument. So maybe I'm just giving an example. Maybe out of 20 cases, he has a fraction, maybe one or two that are private clients. But the majority of his cases come either as an AFC or an 18B, which is the appointed to a litigant, attorney appointed to the litigant by the court. So his money, essentially, his income stream, based on the schedule of the courts, right, published by the courts, in major part comes from the government. So de facto, he's employed by the government. And that's another plausible deniability, right? That's a very common scheme that the government uses everywhere, right? This private government partnership, right? When the government doesn't want to be caught, they outsource their work to private entities. You see it all the time, right? You see it when all those domestic violence organizations are getting money from the government, right? Or the supervisors and so. But it's all underneath it all. It's government budget. So the government is very sneaky. Again, coming back to the bigger topic of encroaching tyranny, right? They just provide multiple tentacles in order to hide that it's all coordinated. Hide somewhat. It's very transparent here behind the scenes. They outsource the work to the government, but the It's. I did the analysis, also public the video. There's basically there are about 10, 15, 20 attorneys who get all the work, all the jobs in Richmond County Family Court. They all are appointed either as AFCs or as 18Bs to a plaintiff or to the defendant. In the cases, they all, and you can see the correlation. Some judges like some attorneys, so they get many cases, and that's how it works. So he belongs to the same clique. He's part of the same group, And that's for all intents and purposes, he is a government employee. So that's why cases against AFCs are allowed to proceed in the federal courts, right? Because using the same doctrine, if you act in concert with the government, then you can be sued. You can be sued. You can be sued
Yes.
as a government employee. So, but Nicholas Margol, that's not the only thing that he did. Just public. So I like to expose that because it needs to be exposed. He again, he never met with me. He never asked for my opinion on what's going on in the case. He spoke with my children about travel to Israel, for which he was admonished even by McFarland. That's not a topic to be discussed. He filed. It's unbelievable. So he filed an affirmation that that somebody in his family died. And when I asked who exactly died, because I couldn't find anything in the papers about that, right? It's a major event. McFarland said, "You are not supposed. You can. You're allowed not to answer the question." Now, why did I ask that? Because I don't trust him. I have other victims of the same court who actually approached me. I think some of them are actually watching here, and they said he used the same excuse in their cases. So probably because of caseload, I don't know. But he said somebody died, and nobody questions them. So he submits the affirmation. That's it. He's out of the case. So I heard allegations of me dragging the case, but in fact, when more than one or two hearings were delayed because of his affirmation that somebody died. And then on another occasion, I also published that he said he submitted an affirmation, not him, his partner, Melissa Lutrigliano. They have a court, they have an office together. And both of them, by the way, work for ACS, notorious ACS, which is CPS, the Child Protection Services arm of the government again. And we all have our opinions about CPS. So he comes from that system, like many judges and attorneys. So his partner submitted an affirmation on his behalf that he was involved in such a severe car accident that he couldn't write the affirmation himself. Of course, the case got adjourned on that date. And in the evening, myself and other victims, we went to protest as we did in front of the judge's house, Jeanette McFarland, completely peacefully, completely legally, or in front of the courts. And he was observed by me actually driving his car, being completely energetic, exchanging engaging in dialogue with us, no signs of any major accident. So it just when you add all these things together, right, he's part of the same the same structure that that just uses government money and drives to the same outcomes that separate fathers from the children, creates the money stream through child support and Title IV matching, right? Funds the courts, fund these assignments, funds these attorneys, right? And this machine just goes on and on and on, and they don't care. They don't care about the children, don't care about anything. And they behave like that in completely, in my opinion, animalistic way on public platforms without any repercussions. I filed complaints against him to the grievance committee and the AFC panel. The grievance committee never got back to me, so I need to follow up. They probably, and unfortunately, I haven't seen any good results from them so far, but they need to be sued themselves. And the AFC panel actually responded to me finally after another reminder saying that they're investigating. So we'll see how that all plays out. So These are the topics that I had for today, Matthew. And thanks, everybody. I see that people are still joining. Candice is saying hello. So thanks, everybody, for watching. Please share the live stream. I think it was interesting. Anything else that you had on your mind?
I think we have everything on my list. We have. Yeah, I think we're good to go here.
Okay, excellent. I'm just pulling up a couple of comments to acknowledge everyone. Jacob saying he probably gets qualified immunity too as a state paid contract. Yeah, qualified is better than absolute, right? Let's see. Mark is saying Tom Girardi.
Going to say that absolute immunity tends to corrupt absolutely. So that's the difference. Yeah.
Yes, I like it. Yes. Mark is saying Tom Girardi out of LA had 200 complaints to the California bar before he was disbarred. Yeah. Well, Nicholas Morgolo is known to the victim community here on Staten Island. I know I was approached by a number of victims, actually. So, and I know at least one is working on a lawsuit against him. I filed a lawsuit against him. He still continued to represent, so-called represent in my case, which is an unbelievable conflict of interest. But we'll see. You know, behind the judges, there's a big sign, right? In God we trust. So people need to remember, you know, we're still under God, all of us. So this record, this torture of children and parents cannot continue forever. God is watching. And I think at this point we can conclude. So thanks, everybody. Matthew, anything, any last words for this stream?
Oh, no, it was a terrific show. And I want to thank everybody. I see all the names on the screen there. And thanks to everybody for tuning in.
Thanks, everybody. And we'll see you in the next video. Logging off. Bye. Okay.